Leaders, I said, praise the Lord. We thank the Lord for this privilege He has given us as leaders in the church. And I pray that the word of God will bear fruit, multiplied fruit in every minister, in our ministries, all our local churches, all our states, all our regions, all our groups, everywhere in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for this privilege. Thank you for the calling. And thank you because you keep us healthy, sound, spiritual, focused, and directed. We're dynamic by the Spirit of the Lord. We're asking, O Lord, that this year will produce great fruit in the ministry in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that the word that comes to us today will bring strength, will bring vision, will bring power, will bring knowledge, instruction, and inspiration in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. Please have your seats. Tonight we're looking at some verses in Revelation chapter 8. You know that the book of Revelation deals with, number one, the glory and the exaltation of Christ, chapter 1. It deals with the period of the church, the age of the church. At the end of every message to the church, the Spirit of God said, "He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches." So it's not limited to those seven churches, speaking to all the churches in every age until the coming of Christ. And then after the message to the church, the sin sheets to heaven. In chapters 4 and 5, we have the revelation of the majesty of the glory of God on the throne. And so we have in those two chapters, chapters 4 and 5, the one that sits on the throne, the personalities, the angels around the throne, the angels and the living creatures before the throne, and then the activities that go on there, praising the Lord, giving honor to the Lord. After that, we have chapter 6. All through chapter 6 to chapter 19 is the period of the great tribulation. So that means that chapter 8, which we're looking at today, is at the time of the great tribulation. But you need to understand, as believers and as Christians, that there is the great tribulation. That's for a period of time. But then there is general tribulation, which takes place every time all through the period of the church. Please understand, there are tribulations in the plural. There is tribulation, meaning trouble, meaning trial, meaning persecution. And there is the great tribulation. If you overcome the tribulation of the present time, the trials of the present time, the temptations and the troubles of the present time, then at the time of the rapture, you are raptured with the church. After that rapture, there's going to be the tribulation. Peculiar, very serious, something that had never been, something reserved only for that time. That's the great tribulation. And tonight, we're not only concentrating on the future generation, the future tribulation, which actually does not concern us, that is, will not be here, the church would have been raptured. We're looking at the present tribulation, and we're looking at the future tribulation. And the message tonight is overcoming the present to escape the future tribulation. Overcoming the present tribulation to escape the future tribulation. Look at chapter 21 of Luke. Luke chapter 21, we're reading from verse 33. Here are the words of Jesus Christ. It says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And then it says in verse 34, and take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, so that they come upon you unawares. He's talking about a future time, and he's talking about that day yet to come. He says, take heed to yourself, be a real Christian, keep on enduring whatever challenges you face. Face those challenges with faith and with strength in the Spirit of God, so that the coming day will not come upon you unprepared, unawares. In verse 35, for as is near, shall it come. The great tribulation will come as is near upon the people of the world. Why? They don't understand anything about the rapture, that's the world, about the great tribulation, about the Antichrist, and about all the events that will take place at that time. Because of that, for as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Verse 36, watch ye therefore. To escape what is coming at a future time, watch ye therefore. To go with the Lord when he comes at the time of the rapture, watch ye therefore, and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. That's the reason we're looking at the message today, overcoming the present, that's the present tribulation, to escape the future tribulation. We're dividing the message to three parts. Number one, awesome silence in times of trouble. Awesome silence in time of trouble. Times of trouble. Number two, astonishing supplication for triumph over tribulation. Astonishing supplication for triumph over tribulation. Number three, awful suffering for transgressors during the tribulation. Let's come to number one. Number one, awesome silence in times of trouble. That word trouble there stands for times of trial, times of testing, times of tribulation, times of the great tribulation, encompasses everything. In Revelation chapter 8 verse 1, and when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. There was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Underline that word, silence. We need to understand that during that great tribulation, all through the tribulation period on earth, there are cries. On earth, there will be suffering. On earth, there will be confusion. On earth, there will be hunger. On earth, there will be earthquakes, there will be turbulence, everything will be noisy. In heaven, there will be the glory of God, there will be the praises of God, the angels and redeemed souls, the saints of God, shouting the praise of God. You have done well. You are now bringing them to judgment. You are a God of vengeance. What you said you will do, you are doing. All of a sudden, in the midst of the noise, noise on earth and noise in heaven, there is a pause. There is silence. Number one, there is the pause and silence during the tribulation. Number two, the purpose of silence during our trials. Understand, our trials are also referred to as tribulation. Jesus said, in the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Paul the apostle said that we need to remember that it is through tribulation we shall come into the kingdom of God, inherit the kingdom. There's tribulation, trial even now, and there is a purpose of silence during our trials. Number three, the power of silence during tribulations. Tribulations in the plural. Your own challenge will be different from my challenge. My own trials will be different from your trial, and the thing that confronts you will be different from mine. But whatever the tribulation, whatever the trial, there is power in silence during tribulations. Let's look at number one, the pause and silence during the tribulation. And you see, it tells us in chapter 8 verse 1, and when he had opened the seventh seal, the first seal had been opened in chapter 6 verses 1 and 2, and then we're told about the second seal, chapter 6 verses 3 and 4, and then we're told about the third seal that comes in verses 5 and 6, and then the fourth seal verses 7 and 8, and then the fifth seal had been opened as well, and then the saints of God in heaven, that is their souls of those martyred says, they cry to the Lord, how long will you not fulfill your vengeance upon the world? And they were told to wait until the rest of them who are to be slain for the word of God, until the number is fulfilled and completed. And then the sixth seal had been opened, and then there are earthquakes and thunders and everything, and the kings of the world, they go to hide themselves, and they're hiding from the wrath of the one that sits upon the throne and the wrath of the Lamb. Now the seventh seal. And when the seventh seal was opened, because of the awesomeness of what is going to take place, and because of the tragedy that is going to come upon the world, because when they had the first part of the great tribulation, they thought they had seen trouble, but now the second part and the final part, you see, the tribulation is for 7 years, and there'll be the first 3.5 years, and then the last 3.5 years, 42 months, 1260 days, and it's going to be a time of real trouble. And because of looking ahead to what was going to happen here on the earth, even the whole of heaven, they went into silence and into a pause. Look at Habakkuk chapter 2. We're reading from verse 13, Habakkuk chapter 2, reading from verse 13, it says, behold, is it not of the Lord of hosts that the people shall labor in the very fire? At that time, the trouble will be so much that those who are walking on the street, it will be as if they are walking through fire. The sun will scorch them, and the heat will be so much. And those who are trying to walk, they're trying to do anything, it will be terrible on the earth. And is it not of the Lord of hosts that the people shall labor in the very fire, and the people shall weary themselves for very vanity? And then in verse 20 of that chapter 2, it says, but the Lord is in his holy temple, let all the earth give silence before him. There's going to be that silence, there's going to be that pause during that time of the great tribulation. In Zechariah chapter 2 verse 13, Zechariah chapter 2, reading from verse 13, be silent, O all flesh, before the Lord, for he is raised up out of his holy habitation. He stands up and is ready now to judge the world in a very fierce way, that Jesus said that such days of suffering had never been. And were it not for the sake of the elect, that is of those Jewish people, those days will not be shortened, and then there will be no life that will be saved. That's the reason why in heaven, all the people in heaven, all the angels in heaven, all those who have been shouting the praise and the glory of God, when they saw the awesomeness of what was going to come, the awful judgment about to come at the opening of the seventh seal, that's why there was pause and silence in heaven. But look at this, number two now, is the purpose of silence during our trials. Even those of us who are Christians, children of God, we're not as quiet as we ought to be. And the Lord is telling us that there was silence in heaven. Is there ever silence in your home? Silence in your heart? Silence in the church? Do we ever keep quiet at all? Look at Job chapter 4, reading from verse 16. It says, it stood still, but I could not discern the form thereof. An image, a personality, an appearance was before mine eyes, and there was silence. In the book of Job, many things happened, and Job did not understand. If Job had been more quiet, silent, it would have been better. If the friends of Job had been more quiet, silent, it would have been better. If the wife of Job had been more quiet, silent, it would have been better. There was silence, and I heard the voice saying in verse 17, shall mortal man be more just than God? There'll be no argument with God. If you observe that silence, something is happening in your personal life, in your family, you don't understand. Something is happening in the local church, in the district church, in the group church, in the city church, you don't understand. Shall man, a mortal man, be more just than God? Who are we that something is happening? We don't even understand the genesis of it, the background of it. Job and the friends of Job did not know the conversation that had gone on before God, between God and Satan in chapter 1. When the sons of God were gathered together, Satan came in the midst of them, and God said, where are you coming from? I'm going to and fro, up and down on the earth. Have you seen my servant Job? All that, and everything that Satan said, and what God said to Satan, Job did not know that. What do you know of the secret counsels of God, of the secret purpose of God? And then something happens, maybe in the church, maybe in our families, and we begin to talk. There should be silence. When there is silence, there's no argument, there is no confusion. You're not going to be challenging God. God, what are you looking at, this and that? There are some people that think they are bold in prayer. When they are not quiet and something has happened, and they go to God almost fighting with God. Shall a man be more pure than his maker? Look at Psalm 39. In Psalm 39, we're reading from verse 2. It tells us about the attitude of David the king. There were things that happened in the life of David he couldn't understand. He had been anointed king in chapter 16 of 1 Samuel, and then chapter 17, Goliath came. He had to confront that. And then in chapter 18, the women were singing, and it wasn't his fault. He didn't tell the women to begin singing. And then from that song, Saul now was saying, I need to get rid of this man. This man is going to be and greater than I. And then it goes on and on that David said, there's only a step between me and death, and yet he was destined for the throne. Now look at verse 2 of Psalm 39. I was dumb, was silenced, held my peace, even from good, and my sorrow stirred was stirred. When you are silent, you meditate. When you are silent, you sing. When you are not uttering any word to any man and you're looking at what is happening, you're meditating on what is happening, it gives you time to have the real problem, let's say this way, the drag at the bottom of the pot to come to the top, and then you can scoop it and you can take it off. Look at verse 3. It says in verse 3, my heart was hot within me while I was musing, I was meditating, I was thinking, I was quiet. The fire burned. You see, there are people, they say they are baptized in the Holy Ghost. Maybe they are. They are filled, they are saturated with the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost comes with fire, with fervency, and with power. But they leak a lot. Their vessels leak, and their hearts leak. Because they talk and talk and talk, that's what got Samson into problem. A lady that she never knew, Delilah by name, they became friends overnight, and then tell me your power. Before you tell somebody the secret of your life, how much time should you have spent together? And what intimacy should you have? A person you are meeting for the first time and you are leaking out, and all the power leaked out, eventually he told a lie. That's what talking and talking all the time, that's what it brings. And you've not told me the real thing, tell me now, and told another lie. The Philistines upon thee, Samson. A person like that, you know, is for evil. And yet Samson kept on talking, you know, until he said, now I'll tell her my heart. And she told her heart. The talking did not help matters at all. The Philistines came, they arrested him, they bound him, they removed his sight, they removed his senses, they removed his strength, they removed everything that he had. He said, I'll go out and shake myself as at other times. The power was gone. But you see, when you are silent, there is trouble, you are silent. There's temptation, you are silent. And there is a difficulty, you are silent, you are watching how things are. It says, my heart was hot within me. While I was musing, meditating, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue. Ecclesiastes tells us, there is time to speak, and there is another time to be silent. Look at verse 4. It tells us in verse 4, Lord, make me to know mine end, that the measure of my days, and what it is, that I may know how frail I am. Can you imagine somebody is sick? Almost everybody knows that he's at the point of death. And instead of being quiet, think about your life, think about your position with God now, and think about the possibility, what if you get healed, praise the Lord. What if this is the last sickness you're going to have before you cross over, praise the Lord, thy will be done. But all through that time, even though it's their last moment on earth and their last day on earth, they are talking and talking and talking. There is anger, there is jealousy, there's complaint, there's murmuring, and there is some forgiving spirit. Everything is making them talk and shout. But the psalmist said, I was silent. And when I was silent, I was telling the Lord, make me to know mine age and the measure of my days, what it is, that I may know how frail I am. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 36, verse 19. Isaiah chapter 36, reading from verse 19. Where are the gods of Hamath, Amath, and Arpach? where have the gods of the Sephavim, and have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Here was a foreign king, an enemy, bragging and boasting, I'll deal with that man. Look at verse 20. It says in verse 20, who are they among all the gods of these lands that have delivered their land out of my hand, at that the Lord Jehovah God in heaven should deliver Jerusalem out of my hands? That's blasphemy. That says something about the Almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that a mortal man should not say. There are people, when they hear anything, the name of our church, or the name of our pastor, or the name of somebody we respect, and the doctrine we preach, and the Bible, and they hear somebody blaspheming that name, and they hear somebody pulling down that name, they say, how about this? We have to rise up and talk. Are we not going to be silent? Are we not going to realize the purpose of silence during our trials? You are a believing sister. You are sanctified. You are saved. You are a real child of God. By the grace of God, your life now, compared with the past, is spotless and clear and clean. The only challenge is you have an unbelieving husband. That's not your fault. You had married before, you were born again. And now you come to church, you come to the workers' meeting. This year, I'm going to serve the Lord more than ever before. And the unbelieving man, he wants you to be at home. And he wants you to prepare whatever it is for all his friends who are coming at this particular time. This is a special period. You see, I've covenanted with my God. I will serve the Lord. And the man begins to talk. Not only that, he talks to say, if he's only talking against me, no problem. I've been living with him all these years. I can endure that. But now he's talking about my pastor. He's talking against my church. He's talking against even the Bible. And he's even mentioning the name of God in a way that nobody should. This time I will talk. My sister, when are we going to see the virtue of silence in your life? And the virtue of quietness in your life? This king blasphemed the name of the Lord. Look at verse 21. In verse 21, but he held their peace. That's silence. They held their peace and answered him not a word. For the king's commandment was, saying, answer him not. There are times in our trials, in our tribulations, there are times in the pressures that come upon us from the world, the Lord wants us to be silent. In Isaiah chapter 41, reading from verse 1, Isaiah chapter 41, verse 1, keep silence before me, O islands. There are people that rush into prayer, and as they come into prayer, they don't meditate on the promises of God. They don't meditate on the precepts of the word of God. They don't think about anything. The same way they prayed last year, and just shouting and shouting and shouting, they come in now. Immediately they come in, you know that brother so and so is there. He's got his place, is always there, and the same way he did last year. You know sister so and so is there, and she has come in shouting, 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 just repeating the same thing. It's like a parrot repeating what the parrot had heard from other people. But the Lord says, when you come, keep silence before me, O islands, and let the people renew their strength. In that silence, in that quietness, there is the renewal of strength. Let them come near. Let them speak. After keeping silent, you meditated on the word of God. You have positioned your mind, your heart, to speak with God, to relate with God. Now, let them speak, and let us come near together to judgment. Look at verse 10. In verse 10, as you are quiet before the Lord, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. If you have the right attitude, I will strengthen thee. If you observe the time you ought to be quiet, silent before the Lord, I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help you. This new year, with new life, with new approach, with new understanding, the Lord will help you. Amen. Where you have failed in the past, you will succeed this year. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Look at number three here, and it's the power of silence during tribulations. The power of silence during tribulations. To start with, understand we're going through times of trial, of trouble, of persecution, of tribulation. And don't look away from the problem of today, the tribulation of today, because you are looking at the great tribulation in the future. Look at John chapter 16, verse 33. John 16, verse 33. These things have I spoken unto you. The Lord Jesus Christ talking to all his disciples, that in me ye might have peace. You will have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. That's not the great tribulation, but while you are in the world, waiting for the coming of the Lord, in the world ye shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Acts chapter 14, verse 22. In Acts chapter 14, verse 22, it tells us, it says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them, actually reminding them, actually encouraging them, exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, not that we may, we must go through much tribulation. And through more tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. Before the rapture, before we enter into that kingdom of God, there's going to be trial, there's going to be temptation, there's going to be tribulation. That's why we want to retain the power of silence at such a time. Let's come to Amos chapter 5. Verse 13, Amos chapter 5, reading from verse 13, therefore the prudent shall keep silence in that time, for it is an evil time. When Satan runs after somebody, and when Satan provokes a David to number the people, and Joab is even saying, O King David, why don't we stop all this and let God himself multiply the people, and the David and the leader and the master and the king will not keep quiet, will say, but do what I've told you to do. I'm the leader here. I commanded you, go and count the people, and whatever happens, put it on me. Are you not going to be silent? I'm not going to keep quiet, because this is an evil time, a time to pause and think, a time to pause and meditate, a time not to act like the people of the world are acting. A man of the world, a woman of the world is shouting on you, and then you go into shouting match too, you shout back on her. The boss conductor is shouting at you, and then you too, you forget who you are, you start shouting on them. And you are in maybe local transportation, and the driver is, you know, here and there, driving here and there, and because of that, we're shouting, driver, don't do that, you want to kill us, and all that. And the driver himself gets into shouting with you, instead of concentrating on the journey, he's looking back, who is that challenging me? Are you going to command, are you going to control my driving? Okay, I will show you something. And then you keep on shouting. Why don't you keep quiet and pray and hand over the journey unto the Lord at such an evil time? Therefore, the prudent, the wise shall keep silence in that time. That's our strength. That's our power. Isaiah chapter 32. In Isaiah chapter 32, we're looking at verse 17. Isaiah chapter 32, verse 17. And the work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness and assurance forever. Quietness and assurance forever. Let's come to point number two now. In point number two, we have astonishing supplication for triumph over tribulation. We're back in Revelation chapter 8, and we're reading from verse 3. Revelation chapter 8, verse 3. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, and he that he should offer it was the prayers of all saints. Was the prayers of all saints. The saints are praying. An angel appeared. He had a censer in his hand. And with that censer in his hand, there is incense. And he collects all the prayers of the children of God, of the saints of God, in that golden altar which was before the throne. In verse 4, it says, and the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints. Remember, the prayers of the saints getting through to the censer in the hand of the angel, ascended up before God unto the angel, out of the angel's hand. Then in verse 5, we're told, and the angel took the censer filled with fire of the altar, and he cast it into the earth. Remember the prayers mixing with the incense in the censer in the hand of the angel. And as fire came on that incense, it brought up smoke for the prayers to the presence of God. And now all that prayer with the incense is cast on the earth, into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake, all because of the prayer of the saints. The three things we're looking at here: number one, assuring partnership with all supplicants. That when we pray, all the saints praying, it says the prayers get into the censer in the hand of the angel, and by what he does, that angel does, that prayer ascends to God. What partnership with the superior, supernatural ones as supplicants. Number two, ascending prayers of the saints. Those prayers, all the prayers of all the saints, then ascend to God, go into the presence of God, and then the result of that, astonishing power of their supplication. Let's look at number one. Number one, the assuring partnership with all supplicants. Would you know that whenever you pray, whenever I pray, you are not alone, I am not alone. Number one, the Holy Spirit helps our infirmity when we pray, our weakness when we pray. And if we don't say the word we ought to say, the Holy Ghost builds it up before it even gets to the Father. Not only that, when we pray, we have the partnership of the high priest. And the high priest is the one to present our prayer with the incense before the Heavenly Father. That high priest is the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you are prayed, he makes intercession for you as well. Let's say, for example, your prayer is on scale 1 to 10. And the way you have prayed, the fervency there, the faith there, the assurance there, the hope there, everything in the scale reaches up to number three. And yet, for the prayer to be fully answered, you need to go through the spectrum and through the continuum from 1 to 2 to 3 up to 10. The Lord Jesus Christ, as your prayer comes in his hand, before he presents it to the Father, he adds what is missing. And so when the prayer gets to the Father, it's like you are prayed up to level 10 and your prayers are answered. And so let's look at Romans chapter 8 verse 34. In Romans chapter 8 verse 34, it tells us, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh continuous tests. He maketh intercession for us. That's why you are victorious. Verse 37, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. The prayers of all the saints, they get into the hand, into the censer, in the hand of that angel, and then is presented before God. It ascends unto God. That's the reason why we can have assurance that whatever God has started in our lives, he will finish, he will accomplish in Jesus' name. In Hebrews chapter 7, reading from verse 25, Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost. You will not die in the middle of your journey. He's able, he's willing, he's ready, he's so powerful to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. Seeing he ever liveth, he ever liveth to make intercession for them. He ever liveth and is making intercession for you. We have partnership with the Lord when we pray. In verse 26, it says, for such an high priest became us, befits us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. And so whenever you come to pray, you come with a good attitude, you come with a simple, sincere attitude, and you come with silence and quietness, and you are meditating on the provision of Calvary, you are meditating on partnership with you in prayer. You don't just jump in to the prayer without understanding your partnership with the Lord, and that your prayer will be answered. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 4 verse 15, it says in verse 15 chapter 4, it says, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. And then he says in verse 16, let us therefore come boldly. You can be quiet and bold, you can be silent and bold, you can be deliberate and you are bold. You don't have to make a noise because you are bold. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This year, every need you have, the Lord will give you help and bring solution in everything in Jesus' name. Look at number two there. Number two there is the ascending prayers of the saints. We're looking at Revelation chapter 8, verses 3 and 4. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, and that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints, all saints, all saints. Are you a part of this? Is your name there? He will answer your prayer. But the prayers of all saints, prayers in the plural, saints in the plural, upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And then in verse 4, he says, and the smoke of the incense, remember, is mixed now with the prayer which came with the prayers of the saints. The incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. Look at Psalm 141, looking at verse 2. In Psalm 141, verse 2, let my prayer be set forth before thee as incense. You know what we read in Revelation? It's not just limited to the time of the great tribulation, even at the time of David, at the time of the Psalms. Let my prayer be set forth before thee as incense, and the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. It's like when Jacob was going away from the father's house and was going to Laban, and Esau was threatening, I'll find him, I'll kill him. And he was threatening, all that blessing he got from Isaac, my father, that blessing will not stick, that blessing will not stay. I will not have it, he will not have it. He's taking away my birthright, and then he's taking away my blessing. None of us will enjoy that blessing. And with that kind of mind, and with that kind of heart, Jacob was traveling. And he came to this place, and he laid his head on a hard pillow. Sometimes when we have trouble, the pillow is as hard as a stone, and we don't know what we're going to be, and where we're going to put our feet, and how the solution will come. And then he saw a ladder from earth to heaven. All his body and all his anxiety and all the panic and all the fear can now get to heaven, because the angels are going from the bottom of the ladder, and then from the lowest rung of the ladder, and they're going to heaven, and then they're also coming back, ascending and descending. And then he saw God at the top of the ladder, and the Lord said, I am the Lord, I am Jehovah, I'm the Lord your God, and I will take care of you. You will go to where you are going, and you will come back. And the blessings of Abraham I give unto you. You understand? As our prayers are sent unto the Lord, all your bodies are sent to the Lord. All your fears are sent to the Lord. And all the panic you have, maybe this will happen, maybe this will happen. I hear that they are threatening, they will catch me, they will get me. And then you go like that, and you offer your prayers to the Lord, all your body will get into the hand of the Lord, and blessings will come down from heaven in Jesus' name. Look at Acts chapter 2, we're reading from verse 32. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 2 verse 32, this Jesus has God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Then in verse 33 it says, therefore being by the right hand of the Father exalted, having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed for days which ye now see and hear. Verse 34, it says, David has not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, the Lord says unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand. And then it goes on. What the verse is explaining is that Jesus has ascended up to heaven. And when he ascended up to heaven, he took the names of his disciples there, and all the promises he had given them, he ascended to heaven and took that there. And then Peter said, now he's ascended to heaven. Everything that he promised us when he was here, he has now shed this, he has now poured it down upon us, which you can see and which you can hear. The Lord has ascended up into heaven for you. All right, for me. and then every promise he had given, he has gone there before the Lord and is telling the Lord, I promised him when I was with him, I'll do this for him. I promised them, I'll do this for them. I am ascended up now, and they're looking up and they're expecting there'll be a fulfillment. And the Father will never say no to Jesus on your behalf in Jesus' name. Amen. Your prayers are answered. Amen. Your tears are wiped away. Amen. All the burdens you have, the Lord has ascended in the presence of God, and they are fulfilled in your life in Jesus' name. Amen. Number three now. Number three is the astonishing power of their supplication. Astonishing power of their supplication. Look at Revelation chapter 8 verse 5. It says, and the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. Understand? The saints of God, all the saints of God, they have made their prayers, and the prayers got into the censer in the hand of the angel, and is mixed with incense, and the mixture of that incense and the prayers of the saints and the fire representing the Holy Ghost, all mixed together, is poured upon the earth, and it says is cast into the earth, and there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. You see, when you read the Bible, we need to compare spiritual things with spiritual. If you only limit this to the time of the Great Tribulation, you miss the point. But look at this now, the astonishing power of their supplication at that time, of our supplication at this time. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 7. In 1 Samuel chapter 7 verse 8. 1 Samuel chapter 7 verse 8. And the children of Israel said to Samuel, cease not, do stop to cry unto the Lord our God for us, that he will save us out of the hand of the Philistines. In verse 9, and Samuel took a sucking lamb and offered it with a burnt offering holy unto the Lord. And Samuel cried, he prayed unto the Lord for Israel, and the Lord heard him. When our pastors pray for you, the Lord will hear them. Amen. When I pray for you, the Lord will hear me. And then he tells us in verse 10, look at the result of Samuel praying for the people of Israel at that time. And as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel, but the Lord thundered a great thunder on that day upon the Philistines, and discomfited them and defeated them and destroyed them and scattered them, and there was meeting before Israel. You see the result here. That's the thunder that came as Samuel prayed, just like we're told in Revelation chapter 8, where we have read that when the censer was poured upon the earth containing the prayers of the saints of God, there were lightnings and thunders and voices and a great earthquake. The same thing happened at the time of Samuel. Look at this in Psalm 18. Psalm 18, we're reading from verse 6. In Psalm 18, reading from verse 6, here is what it's telling us about the time David prayed. In my distress, I called upon the Lord, and I cried unto my God, and he heard my voice out of his temple. He will hear your voice. Amen. He will hear your prayer. And my cry came before him, even into his ears. What's the result of that? Look at verse 13. In verse 13, the Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. In verse 14, it says, yea, he sent out his arrows and he scattered them. That's the result, and that's the answer to the prayer of David. And so we are not limiting this only to Revelation chapter 8, when the saints and the prayers of the saints will be in that censer and to be poured upon the earth. David said, I prayed also, and when I prayed, the Lord sent arrows and thunders and scattered all the enemies. Your enemies are scattered. He shot out lightnings and discomfited them. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, verse 25. Acts chapter 16, verse 25. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, and they sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. This year will be the year of singing for you. No sorrow, no tears, no fear. As you pray, you sing unto the Lord, your song will bring power from heaven and scatter all your enemies in Jesus' name. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake. You remember what we read in Revelation chapter 8, when the prayers were poured upon the earth, voices, lightnings, thunderings, and an earthquake. And here Paul and Silas prayed, and it was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaking. Nobody will imprison you this year. Nobody will confine you this year. All the confinement, imprisonment of sickness, of powers of darkness, everything will be shattered in Jesus' name. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed. You are set free in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number three now. Point number three, awful suffering for transgressors during the tribulation. Remember that we've had the sixth seal, and the seventh seal is now opened. At the opening of the seventh seal, then seven angels appeared, and the seven angels had seven trumpets, and the trumpets are being blown one by one. When the children of Israel wanted to call their people to war in the olden days, Old Testament, they'll blow the trumpet. When Gideon went with the 300 people that followed him, they have a pitcher in their hands and a trumpet, and Gideon too had the trumpet. It was to sound the alarm of war. And now the first angel sounded, and the second angel sounded, and the third angel sounded, and the fourth angel sounded. And now before 5, 6, and 7, before the last three trumpets that will blow, here comes an angel making an announcement. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth. You have been raptured if you are part of the church, the glorious church, at this time, before this time. But then the unbelievers, the sinners who are still on the earth, the inhabitants of the earth, woe unto them by reason of the other voices of the trumpet and of the three angels. Four angels have sounded their trumpet out of seven. Seven minus four, three of the three angels which are yet to sound. And in this place we have number one, the suffering of earth's inhabitants during the tribulation, the great tribulation. Number two, the sorrows of earth's inhabitants for their transgressions. It's because of their transgression, that's why all this will come upon them. But before that time, we have the salvation for earth's inhabitants at this time. At this time now we can have salvation. We don't have to wait until that final time. Let's quickly look at this. Number one, the suffering of us inhabitants during the tribulation. It's a time of tribulation. Look at chapter 9 verses 5 and 6. Revelation chapter 9 verses 5 and 6. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when it strikes a man. It will be so serious in verse 6 that we're told in verse 6, and in those days men shall seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and they shall flee from them. They'll not even be able to commit suicide. The suffering will be so terrible. Why? Because in Revelation chapter 12, verse 12, Revelation chapter 12, reading from verse 12, therefore rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. Inhabitants of the earth, and to the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, that is unto the people on the earth, at the period of the great tribulation, with great wrath, because he knoweth he has but a short time. Let's look at number two. Number two is the sorrows of us dwellers, as inhabitants, for their transgression. Why would they have all that kind of tribulation, all that kind of trouble, and all that kind of devastation, suffering and sorrows at that time? In Psalm 107, reading from verse 17, Psalm 107, verse 17, fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities are afflicted. As it was in the past, so it is at this time, and so will it be at the time of the great tribulation. Fools, why are they fools? The fools have said in their hearts, there is no God. I don't have to reckon with God. I don't have to reckon with his promises. I don't have to reckon with his precept. I don't have to reckon with his commandment. I'm the master of my faith. I'm the captain of my sheep. They're fools because they do not reckon with God. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. You can achieve nothing. They didn't reckon with that. That's why they're fools. Fools because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, they are afflicted. I pray you'll not be a fool. Look at Romans chapter 2, we're reading from verse 8. Romans chapter 2, we're looking at verse 8. It tells us, it says, but unto them that are contentious, they are argumentative. Instead of hearing the word of salvation and the word of forgiveness, they argue. They say, no, that's not for them. Unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there'll be indignation and wrath. In verse 9, it says tribulation and anguish, tribulation and anguish, suffering and anguish, panic and anguish, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first and also of the Gentile. Whether in the past, at the time of the New Testament in the first century until this time, or at the time of the great tribulation, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. But you know, this is the time of salvation, and this is the time of the mercy of God. This is the time you can call upon the Lord, and whatever sins you have committed, he'll forgive, and whatever witness, whatever foolish thing you have said with your mouth, or anything you have acted out, this is still the age of grace, at the time when God is still showing mercy, and there's mercy for everyone here today in Jesus' name. And the mercy will bring the promise of God in your life, and will bring answers to your prayer, will bring salvation, will bring your health, will bring deliverance, will bring every blessing that you desire. That leads us to point number three, is the salvation for us inhabitants at this time. At this time now, where rapture has not taken place, at this time now, the great tribulation has not started, at this time now is a day of opportunity and the time of the grace of God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, we're looking at verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, we're reading from verse 2. It says in verse 2, "For he says, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee." The day of salvation, the day of suffering, that final suffering has not started. You can be saved today if you are not saved. And the day of sorrows, the day of calamities, it's not started today. Salvation can be yours today. It says, "In the day of salvation have I succored thee." Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. It's the day of salvation. As we call upon the Lord, he will answer our prayers. We are calling for an unsaved husband, unsaved wife, unsaved child, unsaved parent, unsaved neighbor, unsaved backslider. He's been saved before, but then he went into the wilderness of the world. As we intercede for them, this is still the day of mercy and the day of grace and the day of salvation. The Lord will save them in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 55, we're reading from verse 6. Isaiah chapter 55, reading from verse 6, "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found." This is still the time when we can seek the Lord, and when we can seek the fulfillment of the promises of God. "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near." In verse 7 it says, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the righteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord." The Lord is expecting everyone that will return fully with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind. Let him return unto the Lord. He will have mercy upon him. Mercy for you today. Mercy for me today. Mercy for everyone today. And the mercy of God will be multiplied in every life in Jesus' name. Return to our God and he will abundantly pardon. Abundantly pardon. The Lord will answer our prayers. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, "As it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment," final judgment will not come until after death. Final judgment will not come. Every moment between now and the time of death, mercy is still available. Grace is still available. Forgiveness still available. Salvation still available. And anytime, morning, afternoon, evening, or night, there's anything that has happened that will try to cut you away from the Lord, you now come to the Lord, meditating upon the promise of God. The Lord will make judgment a way to pass from you in Jesus' name. But remember, if you are pushing the day forward, not today but tomorrow, not today but tomorrow, if you are procrastinating and you are pushing the day of mercy and the day of God's grace away from you, tomorrow, that tomorrow may never come, because it's appointed unto men once to die. After this, the judgment. Look at verse 28. In verse 28, it says, "So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many all of us who are here today, Christ has been offered and he has borne the sins of many. All those who are listening at this time, and all the members of our local churches, all the people that will come during all these covenant services, and all the people you are going to interact with, every time Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, all their sins, and now after we're saved and we're sanctified and we're filled with the Holy Ghost and we're doing soul winning and we're bringing others to the Lord, and we are expecting the coming of the Lord. It says, unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. The Lord is going to appear, and when he appears, he will come for you. Amen. He will come for the whole church. Amen. But he's not going to be bringing, he's not going to sacrifice for salvation at that time. He's going to come that second time without the sin offering. Now unto salvation, he'll say, the time is over, the time is up, church, come up. And then by the grace of God, the dead in Christ shall rise, and you there, and you there, all of us, wherever we are, we're in Lagos, we're in Oyo State, we're in Maiduguri, we're anywhere we are, in Ghana, in South Africa, in Zambia, Mozambique, everywhere the children of God are, in Europe, in America, everywhere, he'll pick us one by one. I will see you there. Yeah. I will see you there. Yeah. All the members of your family will be there in Jesus' name. The mercy is available today. The salvation is available today. Everything we need today, everything is available. And as we pray now, our prayer will ascend up into heaven and into the hands of that angel, and then unto Christ, and then unto God the Father. And that prayer, the answer will be poured down, and all enemies will be scattered and devastated in Jesus' name. I congratulate you, because everything you open your mouth to tell the Lord at this time now will be fulfilled. Why don't you rise up? Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord, I know everything I open my mouth to tell the Heavenly Father now, my prayer will be answered. My prayer will be answered. Rise up and tell the Lord, what do you need? What do you want? You want victory, you want triumph, you want health, you want healing, you want deliverance, you want dominion, you want the fulfillment of the promises of God. You're free to pray, and you're free to call upon the name of the Lord. He will answer your prayer. Open your mouth. Tell the Lord. And remind yourself that through life, there are times we'll be quiet before the Lord. No argument, no contention. In our homes, let there be quietness. Husband and wife, not shouting at one another. There are times I don't understand her. There are times she doesn't understand me. It's not a time for quarreling. It's a time to be silent. Even before the Lord, that you hold your peace. In quietness will be your strength. In silence will be your power. You'll meditate in quietness. You meditate in silence. And as you're musing, as you're meditating, then the fire will burn. And then the Lord will remind you how frail life is, and will show you how to prepare. Prepare for heaven and prepare for the coming of the Lord. Bring that as a quality, as a virtue to your life this time, this year. Students listening to the teacher, while the teacher is talking, you are quiet. You are not proving, I know everything already. Keep quiet. Employees, before the employers, when they're giving us directives, not quickly say, that's all right, I understand. Let there be quietness in the neighborhood. Something is happening. Don't pass comment immediately. Quietness, silence. And in that quietness, in that silence, will be your strength, will be your power, will be a time of meditation. And then you will see the way forward. You wait upon the Lord. That time of silence, that time of quietness will show you the purpose of living, the power for living. And not only that, once in a while, every week, pause. Stand still. Be quiet. Have a time of quietness, a time of silence, a time when you allow the word of God to come to you without any disturbance, without any distraction, and without any panic. Quiet, silent, peaceful, holding your peace before the Lord. Tell the Lord that this quality and this virtue of silence and quietness you will manifest this year. Will not hear your voice in the open, in the bus, in the taxi, arguing, shouting. No fighting in your family, shouting. Quietness. You try to understand other people when you are quiet. Listen to them intelligently when you are quiet. And listen to the word of God in quietness. And the Lord himself will fulfill the purpose of that quietness. Understand when you pray, your prayers go into the hands of the great high priest. What are you asking? What are you telling the Lord? How do you want this year to roll out? What power do you want this year? What passion do you want to manifest this year? What progress do you want to achieve this year? What new possibilities are you thinking about this year? Pray and offer them before the Lord. And your prayers will ascend, will be mixed with the heavenly incense. In that censer, in the hand of that special angel, it will be mixed with fire, poured back on the earth. There will be voices, there will be thunderings, there will be lightnings, there will be a great earthquake, everything shakeable in your life, around your life, everything will be shaken away. And the Lord will put all the enemies into silence. Tell the Lord. We have the assurance that we have partnership with God, with Christ, with the angels. When we pray, let the prayers ascend, not on the basis of your feeling, on the basis of faith, that all those promises you are claiming, all the sound words you stand upon, standing on the promises that cannot fail, and you utter them before the Lord. You offered them before the Lord. And you're saying, Lord, I know I have better understanding this year, better promises this year, greater heights I'm going to reach this year, untold, unlimited blessings I'm going to have this year. Pray. Let your prayers ascend to the presence of the Lord. Your desires, your aspirations, your dreams, your request, the triumph you want to have, the power you want to have, the heights you want to reach, the victory you want to have. Let those prayers ascend to the very presence of God. Link up with Jesus, our Savior. Link up with Jesus, our Redeemer. Link up with Jesus, our great high priest. Let him offer what you are presenting in prayer before the Almighty God, and understand that the Father will never say no to Jesus, his only begotten Son. He will answer. He will answer every prayer. Accept the astonishing fulfillment of your supplication, the astonishing solution. To the problem of your life, accept, receive the astonishing removal of every mountain in your life. Accept the astonishing defeat of all the enemies that rise up against your progress. Accept the turning over of all the lies and deception of Antichrist and deceivers against your life. Accept your victory. Accept that power that moves heaven and earth on your behalf. Astonishing. Astonishing power. Accept your courage. Accept your boldness. Accept your fearlessness. Accept your victory. Accept your forward movement this year. The Lord will not fail you. All the strength you need, all the power you need, all the grace you need, all the miracles you need for your spirit, for your soul, for your body, the Lord has answered. Pray that the Lord will help you to escape the great tribulation that will come upon the earth, so that you'll not be a partaker of the sufferings of earth's inhabitants during the great tribulation. Be ready, be watchful, that when the rapture will take place, you will be a partaker. You're looking up for the appearance of the Lord. And when the dead in Christ shall rise, and we which are alive shall be raised incorruptible, pray that the Lord will find you ready, and you'll escape this seed that shall come to pass upon the people of the world. You'll not partake in their suffering. You'll not partake in their sorrows. You'll not partake in the pain, in the plagues that will come at the time of the great tribulation. This is the day of mercy. Receive the abundant, multiplied mercy of God. This is the day of salvation, full salvation. Receive the full salvation of the Lord. Whosoever at this time shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved, shall be delivered, shall be blessed, shall be favored, shall be healed. Whosoever, it's a time of great possibilities for everyone who prays, standing on the promises that cannot fail, holding on to the promises that cannot fail. Accept. Thank the Lord now, as Jesus thanked the Lord before the grave of Lazarus. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Father, I thank you that you always hear me. But because of the people that stand by, I say these things. Lazarus, come forth. Let that life come into your body, into your life. Abundant life, transforming life, quickening life, heavenly life. Let it come upon you now. It's done. I ask, I believe, I confess, it is done. I have asked, I have asked, I have believed, I confess, it is done. A, B, C, I ask that this year will be the best year I have ever lived. I ask that my prayers are answered. I ask that all the promises of God are fulfilled in my life. It is well with my soul. It is well in my spirit. It is well in my business. It is well in my ministry. It is well with every member of my family. It is well. I ask, I believe, it shall be done. It shall be, even as it was told me. I believe. I confess. I will not consider what I see. I will not consider the feeling of my body. I confess. I'm a peculiar treasure. I confess. I will go from victory to victory. I confess. All things are possible in my life. I confess. It's all right in my life. Heaven said amen to your prayer. Father, we thank you for this glorious day. We thank you for your servants. We thank you for our leaders, brothers and sisters, young people, older people, and we pray everything they have all uttered with their mouth, everything has ascended up unto you. You have answered their prayers in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, as we have asked, as we have believed, as we have confessed, I confirm your blessing upon every life in Jesus' name. This year it is well. In your soul it is well. In your family it is well. At night it is well. On the road it is well. Everywhere you go, it is well. Joy, happiness, health, healing, wealth, prosperity, hope in the Lord, and then progress in the kingdom of God. Every day of this year, every night of this year, every moment of this time, salvation and full salvation, and triumph and victory over your life in Jesus' name. Your neighbors will see it is well. Your enemies will see it is well. Your families will see it is well. The glory of God will shine over you. It is well. It is well. It is well. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Turn to the person by your side there and tell them, it is well.